Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Set us free, O God, from the bondage of our sins, and give us the liberty of that abundant life which you have made known to us in your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
First reading is from Isaiah. Shout out, but do not hold back. Lift up your voice like a trumpet. Announce to my people their rebellion, to the house of Jacob their sins. Yet day after day they seek me and delight to know my ways, as if they were a nation that practiced righteousness and did not forsake the ordinance of their God. They ask of me righteous judgments. They delight to draw near to God. Why do we fast, but you do not see? Why humble ourselves, but you do not notice? Look, you serve your own interest on your fast day and oppress all your workers. Look, you fast only to quarrel and to fight, to strike with a wicked fist. Such fasting as you do today will not make your voice heard on high. Is such the fast that I choose, a day to humble oneself? Is it to bow down the head like a bulrush and to lie in sackcloth and ashes? Will you call this a fast day, a day acceptable to the Lord? Is not this the fast that I choose, to loose the bonds of injustice, to undo the thongs of the yoke, to let the oppressed go free and to break every yoke? Is it not to share your bread with the hungry and bring the homeless poor into your house? When you see the naked, to cover them and not to hide yourself from your own kin? Then your light shall break forth like the dawn, and your healing shall spring up quickly. Your vindicator shall go before you. The glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. Then you shall call, and the Lord will answer. You shall cry for help, and he will say, "Here I am," the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please join me in the psalm. Hallelujah.
Happy are they who fear the Lord, and have great delight in his commandments. Their descendants will be mighty in the land. The generation of the upright will be blessed. Wealth and riches will be in their house, and their righteousness will last forever. Light shines in the darkness for the upright. The righteous are merciful and full of compassion. It is good for them to be generous in lending and to manage their affairs with justice, for they will never be shaken. The righteous will be kept in everlasting remembrance. They will not be afraid of any evil rumors. Their heart is right. They put their trust in the Lord. Their heart is established and will not shrink until they see their desire upon their enemies. They have given freely to the poor, and their righteousness stands fast forever. They will hold up their head with honor.
A reading from Corinthians. When I came to you, brothers and sisters, I did not come proclaiming the mystery of God to you in lofty words or wisdom, for I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. And I came to you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. My speech and my proclamation were not with plausible words of wisdom, but with a demonstration of the Spirit and of power, so that your faith might rest not on human wisdom, but on the power of God. Yet among the mature we do speak wisdom, though it is not the wisdom of this age or of the rulers of this age, who are doomed to perish. But we speak God's wisdom, secret and hidden, which God decreed before the ages for our glory. None of the rulers of this age understood this, for if they had, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. but as it is written, what no eye has seen, nor ear heard, nor the human heart conceived, what God has prepared for those who love him. These things God has revealed to us through the Spirit. For the Spirit searches everything, even the depths of God. For what human being knows what is truly human except the human spirit that is within? So also no one comprehends what is truly God's except the Spirit of God. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit that is from God, so that we may understand the gifts bestowed on us by God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Savior Jesus Christ, according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said, "You are the salt of the earth. But if salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything, but is thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under the bushel basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have come not to abolish, but to fulfill. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth pass away, not one letter, not one stroke of a letter, will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and the Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Billboards with maybe one or two lines from scripture on them. They're usually familiar passages. One line, something taken out of the Bible to send a message. And the line, "Jesus is the light of the world," or "You are the salt of the earth," is one of those lines. I've passed them before. big billboard. And every time I do that, I think to myself, the truth of the gospel is that that's only one line from the whole Sermon on the Mount. And the Sermon on the Mount takes up two full chapters of Matthew's gospel. Disciples are called, we are called to live a life, to be the salt and the light for the world, and it's wonderful. It's wonderful, the image of the light and passing on the light. It's beautiful. But this particular gospel today is important to look at because it is an example how we have to take the reading as a whole. If we were only to take out certain lines here and there, little snippets, we would never really see or even begin to try to understand the ministry of Christ, because it's at the end of today's passage when Jesus begins to define discipleship. He calls his followers to this higher righteousness. They are to be the light of the world. And then Jesus demands a higher standard of faithful obedience. He starts to raise that bar, and when I read that, the pressure's on a little bit. Words from Jesus are so hopeful, they're wonderful, but they're also very challenging. And much like life, sometimes they're not so easy to understand, and not so easy to figure out what we're supposed to do. When I was reading the scripture this week and thinking about it, I recalled this moment of several moments that I had in seminary. It was my first month. I'd only gotten there, been there a few weeks, and I was sitting in a class on church history. And the professor handed out our very first assignment. The first assignment I was going to get from my 3 years that were in front of me. And I remember this image like it was yesterday. I was handed this sheet of paper, and it had the description of the assignment. It's a paragraph about this big. Of a paper that we were supposed to write. And I looked at it, and I lowered my head, and I could feel tears starting to come into my eyes because I started to cry. I looked at this paper, and I didn't understand the assignment. Of course, I didn't want anybody else seeing me get upset, so I just kept my head down for the rest of the class, thinking over and over again, what am I going to do? I mean, I was at Yale, and I didn't understand this assignment. After the class was over, I talked myself into the idea that I was never going to pass, I was never going to graduate, I was never going to be ordained. It was just going to be too hard. And then at the end of the day, I thought, well, I better talk to the professor, and I did. And I went, and I met with the professor, and he looked at me and he said, you really shouldn't get so upset about this. It's one assignment. One. He was more than happy to work it out and meet with me and talk about it. But what he did that was so great is he explained to me, you just got here. I don't expect you to know everything. This is one of so many assignments that you're going to get. And then you're going to be graded on your work as a whole, not just one thing. The seminary set a very high standard for its students, but I set it even higher the first day I arrived. I got there thinking I had hit that bar the very first day. And that became one of many humbling experiences in my life, knowing that I had to ask for help. Learning that I'm not always going to understand something the first time. I'm not going to be able to understand everything all at once. And the same is true for our relationship with God. I think it's right to say that God's wisdom is beyond human understanding. But we have Jesus. We have Jesus' words. We have the Spirit with us. And it's that Spirit that helps us to keep the lamps lit and to keep the salt flavored. Because keeping those lamps lit and keeping that salt really flavored before it wears out, which it can do if you don't do something you're supposed to do with salt, I don't know what, but eventually it can lose its flavor. And it requires a lot of work. But we're not expected to do it all at once or all alone. Our light, which is our faith, is to be shared. For any of us to work at keeping our lights lit or our salt flavored and try to live, as Jesus says at the very end of this gospel, try to live this righteous life. If any of us tries to do that only on our own, I can tell you, it's exhausting and almost impossible. We need to be part of the community of disciples, the community of those people gathered at the bottom of the mountain, keep the oil going into the lamp. Because I can tell you with absolute certainty that if I'd been sent off to a little cabin in the woods to study by myself for 3 years and just received assignments in the mail and had to figure it all out, I can tell you today I probably would not have succeeded. Jesus is not having a one-on-one conversation at the top of this mountain. He's speaking to thousands of people who have followed him. And they hear these words. They hear new words from Christ. And maybe they don't fully understand them. But what they did receive with those words was the understanding of full acceptance and love. And that is the beginning of how we learn to live in the light. Even in a world where things happen that we don't always understand, we can begin to live in the light and share it. When we live in that light, we're living in Christ. We're living the light of Christ, living in Christ. And when we just take our first step to begin to do that, whether we understand it or not, we begin to let go of ourselves. And then we become a part of something. We begin to see Christ acting through us and in us and through others. And then we learn that it's not our own light. We don't own the light, that we're part of it. It's shared. Jesus owns the light. We are the people who are called to shine that light. I want to offer a tiny little story as an example. A priest was making a hospital call. And on her way out of the hospital, a woman came up to her and said, "Can I talk to you for a minute?" "Sure," the priest replied, and they stepped aside in the hallway and went over in the corner. And the woman asked the priest to pray for her. And the priest said, "Well, of course I'll pray for you. Is there anything in particular?" And the woman looked at the priest and said, "I'm really struggling. I'm struggling because my granddaughter has met a woman, and they're living together." And the priest looked at her. And instead of beginning a conversation about what this means, she said, "And you're having a hard time with this?" And the grandmother said, "Yes." But the priest saw in this woman a genuine sense of wanting help, wanting some help, truly, truly wanting to understand, and reaching out and not knowing what to do. There was no judgment. She was simply asking for prayer and help. So the priest put her hand on the woman's shoulder and said, "Do you love your granddaughter?" And the woman nodded, "Yes." "Do you believe that God loves her?" "Yes." "Then continue to love her. God creates out of love." The priest continued, "God created you and me, and God loves us. Your granddaughter is created out of love, and you can love her, even if you don't always understand her actions. Just love her." The gospel is calling us to make a commitment to living a life where we serve in the name and the spirit of Christ. And every day, we're working to achieve that. Every day we are trying to climb that mountain. But we can't do it alone. We have to ask for help. And we can never do it if our demand for perfection or our need to understand fully every single thing that happens in our lives, if we allow that to take over, we cannot live in this light. What keeps these lamps lit is looking to God for help and looking to each other. And in exchange, we take the step and we begin to live in the light, and then we can share it. And I have to say, yes, the gospel does raise the bar. It's a higher standard, but it's reachable. It is reachable if we come to God with openness, humility, and love. We'll never fully know the mind of Christ, of God. But we have the words of Christ, and more importantly, we have the Spirit. We have the Spirit that stays with us, that helps feed that light, that helps keep that salt flavored, and gives us what we need to share and to love. Because at the end of the day, we take Jesus at his word, and we realize that following him is so much more important than understanding everything about him. And when we do that, then we are the light of the world, and we can shine it out to others, and then we can share our good works, which glorify God in heaven. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Let us stand and profess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Please pray with me our prayer for growth.
Gracious God, we ask that you increase our love of you and deepen our faith in you, so that we may be your faithful witnesses in this corner of your creation. Amen.
Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church,
that we all may be one.
Grant that every member of the church may truly and humbly serve you.
That your name may be glorified by all people.
We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons.
That they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments.
We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world.
That there may be justice and peace on the earth.
Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake.
That our works may find favor in your sight.
Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble.
That they may be delivered from their distress.
Give to the departed eternal rest.
Let light perpetual shine upon them.
We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy.
May we also come to share in your heavenly kingdom.
Let us pray for our own needs and those of others. For Michael, our presiding bishop, Dabney, our bishop, Ray, Susie, and for all our retired clergy. And we pray also for St. Anselm's Chapel, St. Augustine's, St. Bartholomew's, St. Bede's, St. Boniface, St. Catherine's. We pray for Donald, our president, Rick, our governor, Randall, our mayor, and the Lee County Commissioners. We pray for the ministries at Iona Hope, especially the lectors. We offer our thanksgivings for the many blessings of this day, for our guests, and for those celebrating birthdays and anniversaries. We pray for Christians, Muslims, and Jews, and all people of faith throughout the world who are suffering persecution for their beliefs. We pray for all who work for peace, especially those who give their lives that it may grow. We pray for all victims of terrorism and violence. We pray for the repose of the soul of Carol Logue, who recently departed this life. We pray for those who are committed to our daily prayers, especially Rebecca, David, Dick, Scott, Rob, David, Mindy, David, Marianne, Betty, Dake, Tom, Ellie, Gladys, Bob, Don, Jean, Bruce, and Mark. In our congregation, we pray for the Thailander family, the Uberti family, the Urich family, the Utz family, the Wade family, and the Wagner family. We also pray for our pets, especially Sheba, Jay, Riley, Ginger, Boogie, Cat Cat, and Jay. Are there others for whom we should pray? And blessings for which we give thanks.
Peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you. from your face shine on us. Let me be saved. Let me may have life to find our way in the darkest night. Let your light shine on us. Lord, let your grace from your hand fall on us. Lord, let your grace from your hand fall on us.
By the lakeside, by blessing the gifts of a few people. Bless these gifts to the feeding of the needy, and bless us in your service, for we ask it in your name.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
All thanks and praise are yours at all times and in all places. Our true and loving God, through Jesus Christ, your eternal word, the wisdom from on high by whom you created all things. You laid the foundations of the world and enclosed the sea when it burst out from the womb. You brought forth all creatures of the earth and gave breath to humankind. Wondrous are you, Holy One of blessing. All you create is a sign of hope for our journey. And so as the morning stars sing your praises, we join the heavenly beings and all creation as we shout with joy.
Santo, 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 Nicora, Santi, Nora.
universe, creator of all, your word has never been silent. You called a people to yourself as a light to the nations. You delivered them from bondage and led them to a land of promise. Of your grace, you gave Jesus to be human, to share our life, to proclaim the coming of your holy reign, and give himself for us, a fragrant offering. Through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, you have freed us from sin, brought us into your life, reconciled us to you, and restored us to the glory you intend for us. We thank you that on the night before he died for us, Jesus took bread. When he had given thanks to you, he broke it, gave it to his friends, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, Jesus took the cup of wine, said the blessing, gave it to his friends, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." And so, remembering all that was done for us, the cross, the tomb, the resurrection, and ascension, longing for Christ coming in glory, in presenting to you these gifts your earth has formed and human hands have made, we acclaim you, O Christ.
Dying, you destroyed our death. Rising, you restored our life. Christ Jesus, come in glory.
Send your Holy Spirit upon us, and upon these gifts of bread and wine, that they may be to us the body and blood of your Christ. Grant that we, burning with your Spirit's power, may be a people of hope, justice, and love. Giver of life, draw us together in the body of Christ, and in the fullness of time, gather us with Columba and all your people into the joy of our true eternal home. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, we worship you, our God and Creator, in voices of unending praise.
Blessed are you now and forever. Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
This is the true bread which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world.
Whoever eats this bread will live forever.
So come to this table, you who have much faith, and you who would like to have more. You who have been here often, and you who have not been here for a long time, you who have tried to follow Jesus and you who have failed, come. It is Christ who invites us to meet him here.
Eat this bread, drink.
Thank you.
Now in joyful thanksgiving for all the gifts we have received, let us pray together, saying, God of
abundance, you have fed us with the bread of life and cup of salvation. You have united us with Christ and one another, and you have made us one with all your people in heaven and on earth. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world, and continue forever in the risen life of Christ our Savior.
May Christ, the Son of God, be manifest in you, that your lives may be a light to the world. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Amen.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia.